A very brief introduction to the beat generation with DaveO.
Two of the best minds of my generation, destroyed by madness, starving, hysterical, naked, dragging themselves to the Negro streets at dawn, looking for an angry fix. Angel-headed hipsters, burning for the ancient heavenly connection to the starry dynamo in the machinery of night. Who poverty in tatters and hollow-eyed and high, sat up smoking in the supernatural darkness of cold water flats floating across the tops of cities contemplating jazz. Who bared their brains to heaven under the L and saw Mohammedan angels staggering on tenement roofs illuminated. Who passed through universities with radiant cool eyes, hallucinating Arkansas and Blake-like tragedy among the scholars of money and war.
I'm standing in front of a bookcase filled with very important looking books to make me seem very smart. Is it working? How about if I hold a pipe? All right, maybe not. I come to you today to provide a brief introduction to the beat generation. And this could be a whole series of lectures, but for our intents and purposes today, we're gonna rock through a few things and give you a few highlights. And at the end, I'm gonna show you my address so you can send me postcards with questions and other things that you've discovered. My aim is to light a few sparks in you to discover on your own. So, first of all, we have to think about what America, USA was like in the late 1940s, early 1950s, when the beat generation was sort of coming together. The US had won World War II, along with allies. The US rocked in late and came out looking really good and powerful. But along the way, the US kind of lost its soul. There was the nuclear bomb and the conundrums about that. The middle class and the American dream. Yeah, it's there, but not for everybody. There was segregation. Segregation was still like legally allowed. Sexism, of course, racism in all its forms. There was still this hung-upness on America means to be Christian and to be capitalists. Does it really? Does it say that in the Constitution? And the idea of what constitutes success was being questioned by people, including those who went on to become the beat generation. Now, the beat generation, I'm going to say some people have a rough time with this term and split hairs about who's included and who's not and what it really means and the meaning of beat, whether it's beatific, whether it's beat down. There's all kinds of interpretations, but we're going to let that go because we humans love to give labels to things. And anyway, few things that sort of define the beat generation, because the principal characters, which I'll get to in a minute, really had different backgrounds and different ways of writing, but were kind of grouped together by geography, circumstance, and the fact that they were all making things. The guiding point of this was really the importance of prose and their writing and their craft over big ideas. They were taking writing and literature, capital L literature, away from the Ivy Leagues and the tweed jackets and the Shakespeare and Tennyson and, you know, sure, great writers or whatever, right? But we, regular folks, should be allowed to write too. And the things that we have to say are important. So messing with form, reinventing form. It didn't just have to be novels or sonnets with their exact parameters of poetry, but you could do any kind of writing. So a couple examples of this is Jack Kerouac's noted novel On the Road, as well as many of his other books, were written in one big spontaneous, no paragraph break, no separate pages, scroll or roll of paper. That was actually, there's a lot of stories about this, but it's Japanese architect paper, kind of taped together and feed it through his typewriter so he didn't have to mess around with changing the spools. And in fact, you can, and it was an editor's nightmare, but you could get the book in now reissued in the original scroll roll format, as well as the more conventional style with paragraph breaks. There's a lot more to say about that, but spontaneous prose. First thought is your best thought. Don't overthink it. which means that when we write or express ourselves, a lot of times we go through this self-editing process where we think, oh, well, that's too much. I'm telling too much of myself. Is this good? How does this sentence look? And you get hung up on the details rather than pouring your guts out and just letting it roll and letting it flow. And that's where, you know, where art starts to hurt a little bit, but it also, when you are prepared to back it up with your personal integrity, where art really happens. And free verse, you know, I mentioned poetry with iambic pentameter and this kind of form and that form and the other form. And you get dudes like Allen Ginsberg, who we heard off the top with his seminal poem Howl. And it was this big, it was a lyrical, but not rhymy. It had rhythm and it had cadence and it had dynamics and it had all kinds of different shifts to what would seem like verses and choruses almost. It was almost a little bit biblical. But it didn't rhyme. It didn't have the same number of syllables in every line. And then you get something like various books of haiku. So Jack Kerouac and others, besides writing one long riff of a novel, were also writing very short things that could be interpreted as haikus. Or here's an example, San Francisco Blues. Just little short observational poems, just seeing what he sees out in his life. Like, we can all do that. But at the time, that was a little bit revolutionary. All right, next point here is inclusive-ish in asterisks, because this, in the 1940s, 1950s, it was still a white dude's world. But they were collaborating together. I have examples. Rather than competing, I should have organized this, huh? Here we go. Here's a... Jack Kerouac and William S. Burroughs doing a book together where they were changing off chapters. So instead of competing, they said, well, we can all do our own thing, but let's all support each other. Here's Allen Ginsberg and Gary Snyder. They were traveling together for a while in India, and they both have India journals and Passage Through India. So rather than competing, let's collaborate. Let's see what we can do together. Constantly handing their work back and forth, and then the letters and the correspondence from doing so actually became works of literature in themselves. But when I say inclusive, you know, it was this kind of sense of being working class and away from the university educated, necessarily establishment where you send your works to the big publishers in New York and they are the mandarins who decide, oh, this is worthy or this is not worthy. There was a lot of celebration of Black and Mexican culture, and this gets a little awkward because some of the vocabulary that's used in these topics is a little offside today. You know, and even some people say, well, you're trying to co-opt Afro-American culture with talking about jazz and all this, but it's really a celebration of these different experiences, exploring of what it means to be someone else and interacting in their circles, in their culture. So it's worthy of a discussion. I'll leave it at that for now. But yeah, it was a lot of white dudes, but also queer dudes, you know? At the time, homosexuality was just not something you talked about, or bisexuality or anything like that. But there was a lot of queer dudes doing their thing in this mix, and it comes up in the books and it freaked people out. People of color, people of different sexuality, people of different religions. Oh my God. All right, next is global mindset. Now now it's relatively easy to go, well, you know, traveling. You look it up on the internet, you buy a ticket, you go to a place. At this time though, aside from going to the war, most people never really went much beyond their hometown or their state or their county or whatever. But Jack Kerouac was famous for being on the road and driving here and there. And him and his contemporaries often worked railroad jobs, worked merchant marine jobs, and did a lot of rambling and traveling. A lot of them developed this triangle of San Francisco, New York, Mexico City, also Morocco. I guess that would be a square. And then there was also a sense of exploring India, which I mentioned, and also Japan. And there was a real interest in Buddhism, especially Zen Buddhism, particularly sparked by a dude named Gary Snyder, who I'll talk about in a minute. Next, seeking and questioning. And this is really the core thing that starts a new literary or music movement, is breaking down these norms and seeking something new, seeking some kind of new truth, redefining what is holy, redefining what constitutes religion, religion of self, religion of sex, religion of exploration. Let's look at Eastern religions and remix them and throw them into our own background, which might be Jewish in the case of Allen Ginsberg, or Catholic in the case of Jack Kerouac. And, you know, let's mush them all up. What really matters and means something in this world? Is it buying, having the two cars in your garage and being the most powerful country in the world? Or is it being true to yourself and getting to understand people of other experiences and other cultures and thinking that that in itself is holy? There was also a lot of sex and drugs and jazz. This was before the rock and roll era, but also putting these forms together and talking on top of jazz and interacting with this music really sparked a lot of what we saw to come later. All right. So, notable characters. I mentioned a lot of these right off the bat there. Jack Kerouac, novelist, poet, and a French-Canadian Catholic from Lowell, Massachusetts. He died in 1969 at the age of 47 after finding sudden fame in 1957 after the publication of On the Road that he had written years before. Tried to shop around, tried to publish, and suddenly found overnight fame and had a little problem with the alcohol and, well, not a little problem, and handling fame and what that meant, being the spokesperson for a generation. Allen Ginsberg wrote Howl, Allen and so many other books of poetry. Jewish guy from New York, and I only mention Jewish because this comes up a lot in his work, but then he traveled all over the world bringing poetry and connecting a lot of these generations that followed together, growing a big beard and working for all kinds of, whether it's free speech. His book Howl was deemed obscene. And Lawrence Ferlinghetti, down here on the list, the publisher from City Light's book, I know I'm throwing a lot of stuff at you, went to court, changed the ruling about obscenity. So all this, you know, now you can listen to music that has, well, cuss words in it. And that's really goes back to this obscenity trial. William S. Burroughs was an older dude, and he came for money. The Burroughs adding machine, family fortune. And gosh, Burroughs is a bit of a handful to try to describe. He wrote a book called Naked Lunch, which is surreal. This is his best known work. And it's surreal and it's weird. A Cry from Hell, a brutal, terrifying, and savagely funny book that swings giddily between uncontrolled hallucination and fierce, exact satire. Burroughs was a little bit of an elder statesman to them, and he lived a phenomenally long time despite his predilection for some dangerous substances. And again, connected, maybe you've seen, you know a band called Nirvana, 90s? Anyway, Kurt Cobain had some famous visits with Burroughs. There it is. I'm trying to connect generations with like 30-year-old cultural references. Yeah, good luck. All right, Gary Snyder, you know, and I hesitate to mention because some folks go, oh, Gary Snyder, not a beat. Gary Snyder is a wonderful human being, still alive in Northern California at 91, 92 years old. Fantastic poet, but also a naturalist essayist. He came from the Pacific Northwest, like me, climbed mountains, went to sea as a sailor, ship hand, and ended up in Japan studying Zen in Kyoto and learning Chinese, learning Japanese, and still continues to write and really a hero of mine, as evidenced on the bookshelf. Then there's a guy called Neal Cassady. Here's a great picture of Jack and Neal together. And Neal came from Denver, Colorado. He was a renegade, juvenile delinquent, and but an endless source of energy and inspiration and love for a lot of these other writers. Now, Neal published some stuff of his own, but more importantly, he was a character that ran through the Beats to later to the Merry Pranksters, On the Bus. There's Grateful Dead songs written about him. Grateful Dead, ask your dad, uncle, grandpa, grandma. So a hugely influential character, that a fellow who comes up as a character throughout a lot of these writers' works. Okay, you with me? Okay, I got another list of other characters, because as soon as you say these people, then other people say, well, what about, this isn't a 3-month class. This is a 30-minute class. Now, if you're to trace this back and say, when did all this really begin? October 1955, six galleries, six poets for free, free, no charge, donations for wine and postcards, and they made a poster. They got together and they did a poetry reading. You just get together with your friends and say, hey, come on over. They sent out like, you know, a tweet space, you know, TikTok message in the form of a postcard. And it was the first time that Allen Ginsberg, Jack Kerouac, Neal Cassady, Gary Snyder, Philip Whalen, Lawrence Ferlinghetti, and other notable people who I should name were all in the same room together. And this is sort of a cataclysmic event. It's the first time Allen Ginsberg read Howl. Later on, Lawrence Ferlinghetti, who has a bookstore called, who just passed away the other last year at 101, 102 years old, said, let's publish this book, Obscenity Trial, Legends Follow. So the thing that's great about this is it shows that you can just put out the word to your friends and say, hey, I'm playing some music, I'm doing this thing, I'm doing some spoken word, I'm telling some stories, show up and see what happens. And you too can start a whole revolution, a renaissance as it were. All right, oh, here, I have another thing. This is, there's no recording of this original reading, but people have tried to recreate this with different CD sets and series. And it's actually a great time to be interested in this stuff. It was just Jack Kerouac's centenary. All these archives are coming out and starting to work their way into university collections and becoming available. You know, in the last few years, there's more records, and the CD set has a lot of the poets who read at this original event. So again, it's crossing over generations and movements, which we should talk about next. Roots and branches. So, you know, this term beat, you got to give names to a thing, but then it kind of got mutated into beatnik and became kind of this pop culture thing. And there was cheesy TV shows and hey man, and like the hep cat language and berets and little goatees. And it got mutated like everything does, right? You know, someone comes up with something interesting and then everyone cheeses it out. Yeah, it happens with that. So the beats, the hep cats and beatniks and the mutations thereof. There was the Merry Pranksters, which, you know, this bus called the Further Bus, Ken Kesey, who wrote One Flew Over a Cuckoo's Nest, Ken Babbs and other characters loaded up this bus and went on rampaging adventures around across the country. You know about hippies and yippies. Hello. You know, Woodstock, and the yippies were more political. And, you know, 1968, maybe if you've heard about the riots at the Democratic National Convention in Chicago, the police riots, you know, and I mention this because these guys like Cassady and Ginsberg were connecting these generations and cultures and doing poetry readings in the case of Ginsberg, or driving the bus in the case of Cassady. DIY punks. This is, you know, when I was growing up. When I was growing up in the 80s, there was all this a pushback against, you know, you have to have a label and $1 million to go in the studio to record an album. And, you know, people said, well, we can just take a 4-track recorder and make an album, and we'll make Xerox machine fanzines, which are basically poetry chapbooks in a different way, and put them out into the world. Punk rock. Punk rock doesn't mean mohawks and pierced things. It means certainly DIY, do-it-yourself music and promotion, whatever. Now, also a note here for the folkies, and this is a big deal. I should be mentioning, you know, Bob Dylan especially was hugely influenced by Jack Kerouac. And and this same scene, when this was all kind of coming up in New York, there would be nights at coffee shops with acoustic singer-songwriter types and poets all intermixed together. You don't see much of that anymore, but you do at like open mic nights at like cafes and whatnot. And even I mentioned, you know, Nirvana, you know, the grunge years, talking about things that have a label that doesn't really fit. Certainly a connection there. And, you know, this whole feeling of getting back to the land, living life on your own terms, redefining what success means, and living cheap and cheerful and keeping it weird and making art for its own sake and putting it out there in whatever form and however it bounces back to you, that's great, man. The important thing is that you put your heart and your soul and your guts into making the best piece of art that you can make. Now, with the wonders of the internet, it's a whole different thing to publish something. I love to print things out and mail them out into the world. I love to put things up on an internet thing. You know, any way you want to do it, that's fine, right? It's the important thing is, did you put your best efforts into making this whatever it is that you made? And I even put a note here for digital nomads, which is another term I hate. But, you know, I used to do a lot of rambling around the world. And there's a lot of people who are making money wherever they go, through computers or whatever. But it's the same feeling of being location independent. And this can be traced back to the Beats, certainly. Okay. Homestretch, here's another list of names. And I'm not going to run down the names and tell you about each of them because then I'll never get done here. But here's a list of names that you can research and find your own hero and champion that you want to explore their work. If you're curious, I'm going to show you an address here at the end while we play some Jack Kerouac so you can hear the voice. so it'll make a little more sense. But you can send me a postcard asking me about any of these folks. And there's lots of people that are still doing this as contemporary artists. And I should include them on this list as well because these, you know, it's not about enshrining dinosaurs, but there's a lot of biographers and a lot, the Renaissance continues. And I get a little hesitant about the biographers sometimes because it's like enshrining dinosaurs or freezing something in amber, where what I get from the Beats is here it is. You're a genius all the time. You're a genius too. You have something interesting to say. Your unique perspective and experience in the world, whether it be a lonesome traveler or anything else, is relevant. It doesn't take a million-dollar publishing contract for your words to be valid. So whatever form you want to express yourself in, whether it be painting, whether it be words, whether it be music, whether it be sculpture, or whether it just be hanging out and having interesting conversations with your friends and recording them, that's all valid. So you should do that. And if you do that, and let me know, I'll be your first fan and I'll say, hey, right on, that's great. It's not about the judgment. It's not about the accolades. It's not about the likes. It's not about the reviews and the critics. It's about you and your people and your experience and your life. So with that, let's listen to Jack and I'll show you my address. Send me a postcard. And I love to talk about this stuff. Obviously, I'm just going to give you a nice view here of the bookcase, which is elegantly arranged with all kinds of things. Here's a lovely painting by Jonathan Collins. Thank you, Jonathan, of Jack Kerouac. Another tribute CD with a bunch of artists doing things dedicated or about Jack Kerouac that just came out for its 100th birthday. Okay, smile so I can take a picture of you. Okay, got it. Over to the record player.
I saw in the clouds, huge and massed above the fiery golden desert of evenfall, great image of God, with forefinger pointed straight at me, through halos and rolls and gold folds that were like the existence of the gleaming spear in his right hand, which saith, come on, boy, go thou across the ground. Go moan for man. Go moan. Go groan. Go groan alone. Go roll your bones alone. Go thou and be little beneath my sight. Go thou and be minute as seed in the pod. Go thou, die hence. Now this world report you well and truly. Anyway, I wrote the book because we're all gonna die. So in the last page of On the Road, I describe how the hero, Dean Moriarty, has come to see me all the way from the West Coast just for a day or two. We've just been back and forth across the country several times in cars and now our adventures are over. We're still great friends, but we have to go into later phases of our lives. So there he goes, Dean Moriarty, ragged in the moth-eaten overcoat he brought specially for the freezing temperatures of the East. Walking off alone, and last I saw him, he rounded the corner of 7th Avenue, eyes on the street ahead, and bent to it again. Gone. So, in America, when the sun goes down, and I sit on the old broken down river pier watching the long, long skies over New Jersey, and sense all that raw land that rolls in one unbelievable huge bulge over to the West Coast, all that road going, and all the people dreaming in the immensity of it. And now I know by now that children must be crying in the land where they let the children cry. And tonight the stars will be out, and don't you know that God is Pooh Bear? The evening star must be drooping and shedding her sparkler dims on the prairie.
which is just before the coming of complete night that blesses the earth, darkens all the rivers, cups the peaks, folds the final shore in. Nobody knows what's going to happen to anybody besides the forlorn rags of growing old. Think of Dean Moriarty, I even think of old Dean Moriarty, the father we never found. Think of Dean Moriarty, I think of Dean Moriarty.
At the baggage claim, where you fall apart, it's the thing you do, where you stay awake for 20 hours just to see firsthand what Kerouac was talking about. And when you can, you should read the books that I lent to you. Haven't read them yet, but I'm meaning to. When you give them back, you can crease the page, and I won't mind.